Hello everyone, my name is Chris Sensor. Static spacecraft testing. Why, what, when, etc. This is the whole thing, right? We talk about dynamic testing a lot here, but static testing is necessary as well to make sure that the rocket itself isn't going to collapse from these loads during flight. So you can see there's various stages that occur during a spacecraft flight. And each one of these stages experiences different static loading conditions due to constant acceleration during launch and things like that. To test for these static loads, there's really three options for a spacecraft. You can put this thing on a centrifuge and spin it around, and you'll get a constant acceleration that way. You can use a static load frame, also known as a wiffle tree in some places. And this is a big frame, and you apply static loads directly with some type of typically hydraulic actuator or some type of pulley gantry system. And there's the third option here, which we're going to talk about today, and this is sine burst testing on a shaker. Very exciting stuff here. Option one, centrifuge. And this is a picture of a big centrifuge with a spacecraft on it, and this thing spins around and around and around. And you can imagine that people get very anxious when you have a $1 million spacecraft on something like this spinning around and around. Plus, you need a dedicated facility, and there's very few of these around, and even fewer with the large capacity that you need for some of today's big satellites that we test. That's maybe a less attractive option than maybe option two here, which is a big static load frame. Now, this doesn't require a big centrifuge and all the safety stuff that goes along with that, but we still have a situation where we do need a dedicated facility. It's another lift, another test, another way we have to reorient the spacecraft for testing. And each one of these tests is a custom setup. They're all ad hoc, depending on the spacecraft that you have set up. And they're really not possible to do on an assembled spacecraft. You need to have some type of frame or shell available for this kind of testing that can be instrumented for qualification. Now, we don't like to do these quasi-static tests on a fully assembled spacecraft, but you can. Now, drawbacks of these quasi-static tests. Our load cases are not unidirectional. We have both compression and tension being applied, right? Because we move up and down or back and forth. And our load cases are not like that during flight. It's constant acceleration, so we're typically always in compression. So that needs to be considered. You might need to overtest in one area of your structure to achieve the required loading in another area. Our mechanical impedance is inherently different here than in an assembled on the rocket situation. So we might have difficulty with that compromise. We might need to do this in multiple axes. Again, this isn't so much of an issue because we're going to be moving that spacecraft for shaker testing anyway, but still, it's a multi-axis test. You'll do horizontal and axial. You might get some dynamic amplification. We'll talk about that in a little bit. But the idea with this quasi-static test is we're well below the first mode of the test article, and so we don't get any resonant amplification. All that being said, the spacecraft is always going to be on a shaker at some point anyway. So it's one less thing that you have to do to reorient the spacecraft. So there's no additional lift. It's tucked in with this other kind of dynamic testing that we're doing. And so we don't have much additional time added as opposed to taking this off the shaker and going to another facility or beforehand to do that. Here's what we need to do for this quasi-static load test. We need to come up with a pulse. And in order to come up with a pulse, we need to figure out what the first mode of the spacecraft is. Now, we can do this from some FE data, or we can do this experimentally by doing a low-level sine sweep. Again, something that's typically done anyway when you're doing a shaker test. We'll do a low-level sine sweep and figure out what our first structural mode is. On this little demo that I have here, that first mode's around 48 hertz. And our test specifications, guidance out there from NASA and ESA and other space agencies in the world is we don't want to have a frequency higher than 1/3 of the first mode of the test article, DUT, device under test. In this case, we're at 16 hertz, is 1/3 of this approximately. Now, why doesn't it look like this is 1/3 away from this? Well, because I have log spacing. Rest assured that we're basically 2/3 of the way down from this maximum frequency at 16 hertz. Now, why do we want to have that frequency below our first resonant frequency? Well, you might have seen this little GIF or GIF or whatever we're calling them these days before. And you can see below resonance, we have our base excitation and our response. They're approximately the same amplitude and they're in phase. Once we get to resonance, we start to see this amplification. And past resonance, we see a decrease in amplitude. So we want to be in this area down here so that we're getting this static loading and we're not getting this dynamic amplification that happens here. So if we're down here, we're going to be doing rigid body motion and not seeing some amplification. We can play around with that in a little bit on the shaker, and I can show you exactly what we mean by that. After we figure out what that frequency needs to be, then what we're typically looking at is 5 to 10 cycles at that frequency at the full amplitude level that you want, with about as many cycles for ramp up and ramp down. And that's what we see over here, right? A couple cycles to ramp up, a couple cycles at full level, and a couple cycles to ramp down. And that amplitude is selected by figuring out what we need to drive our structure at to reach our necessary loading from our design criteria. That can typically be done by instrumenting your structure with strain gauges, but it can also be extrapolated from pretest data or modeling data to figure out what that amplitude needs to be. And then once we get results, we can do things like calculate our axial loading and our load line calculations. All right, so there's a bunch of equations that go into that as well. There are some limitations to these quasi-static tests, and it all is our same risks as testing on a shaker, right? We don't want our satellite to fall over like this, so we want to make sure that we're following all our procedures and stuff. But of course, you have potential exposure to unintended shocks from shakers hitting limits, overtest from stiction in the shaker. That's where perhaps on a horizontal slip table, we have a little bit of extra voltage that we need to just overcome that coefficient of static friction there. And so we have a misidentification of what our transfer function is and therefore a drive voltage, which brings us to this idea here, right? Once you send this pulse out, that's it. You send the pulse and then you see what happens. You cannot correct during the pulse. Pulses are corrected in between being sent to the shaker. So you send a pulse out, measure the response, calculate what the change in drive needs to be to make that pulse better, and send it out again. There's a whole bunch of documents here on guidance for this. You want your coherence to be really, really high between your drive and your measurement channel. And if you don't know what that means, I'll show you in a second when we go into the software. Here we go. We're in shock control right now. And I'm going to switch my section to sine sweep. Just show you, this is the sine sweep that I had done earlier to identify what that resonance is. You can get that information from the pretest as well. So we have our channels set up here. We have a control and a measure. And I'm just going to reduce that there. Here we can do our system identification. So for those of you familiar with system identification, this will be a review. What we're doing here is we're sending out a low drive voltage to the shaker. We can see the shape of that here is a PSD. And we're going to take a look at our responses here. Okay, so we can see getting a pretty flat response. And we can see coherence here too. And that's pretty high. And that's what we were talking about before. If this coherence is low, we're going to have a poor estimation of what our drive needs to be to make our pulse. So we can go into system verification here before we run the test and identify what our frequencies are as well here. So we can see from our transfer function here, we've got this resonance right around 47 hertz. And zoom in a bit, snap right to it. What do we see? 47.66 is the estimate here. We can confirm that we need our excitation to be below that. So the question is now, how do I define this pulse, right? If you go into profile editor and shock here, typically we're in classical mode here and you pick a shock pulse. Here we're going to go to measured and we're going to navigate to this pulse that we're going to create in the pulse creator. And that's a tool that you can find. So if you go into your test lab folder and you go into tools, so we'll just go one up from here. Typically you're in this folder when you click on your desktop link. Down below there is tools. And then we have our pulse generator. So if we double click on that, comes up with this little tool here. And we have a couple options. Load pulse parameters will load the pulse parameters that we have in here from a previously generated pulse. So if I hit that, I can see, all right, I picked 16 hertz and an amplitude of 3 G's with 5 ramps up, 5 down, and 5 at full level with a sampling rate of 3200 hertz. And from here, we'd pick sine burst if we were doing this fresh. I'm just going to put in, let's see, a 10 hertz pulse as well. And we'll see how that looks. So we'll do 10 hertz. I'll hit process. Now what this does is it dumps this into the active section. So now if I go back to Navigator and I look in my active section, which is sine sweep, I now see I have a couple different pulses in here. Oh, that's sine sweep. There I am. So there's our 10 hertz, there's our 16 hertz. And we can display that here to take a look at it as well. Here's our 10 hertz pulse, here's our 16 hertz pulse. Okay, so right now we've got our 16 hertz pulse loaded at 3 Gs. I'm gonna set this for 1000 hertz and hit save. All right, we've done our system identification. We can see what our response looks like. And now we can go and run. One last step I wanted to show you here. So to pull in that pulse, you hit measured here and select time block, and then you're going to navigate to where your test is. So I'm here in slab data. So here is our pulse, and then hit okay, and it pulls it in. All right, and you can even scale it right in here. So if I wanted to do a lower amplitude level, it'll rescale it in here as well. All right, so we've done our system identification. And now we can go into shock control. I'm going to hit arm here. And we can see exactly how this is going to go. I'm just going to hit start. And then this is like a regular shock test. I have this set for manual control, so it's waiting for me to say shoot. And send a pulse out. And down here in the bottom, we can see the blue is our control channel pulse and the pink is our response. And you can see that it's pretty close, but maybe my frequency is still a little too high here. So let's hit, because I'm getting this amplification, so let's hit stop. I haven't tried this yet, so we all know how well that always works to try something brand new live in front of an audience. So I'm sure everyone's on tenterhooks here as I load in a different frequency pulse. I'm gonna go back here and I'm gonna load in this 10 hertz pulse. And let's see how we do there. And this wants less of a repetition rate. Okay. All right, let's see what happens now. All right, and start, and we'll send a pulse. And it's correcting. Yeah. So we can see as we went lower in frequency, we are now further away even from that dynamic response, and we're getting pretty close to rigid body motion where our excitation and our response are rather overlaid. That's pretty much everything on doing a quasi-static sine burst test in Test Lab. I'll pop up the PowerPoint again. Here's my contact info. Thanks, everyone. Bye.